I thought that I would make a video covering the various projects I did during the summer, though some things are continuations of previously covered projects. For those of you who are fans of my Logisim CPU series, don't worry, there are some very interesting developments I'll share in a future video. This video took longer to make because some of the projects are ongoing past the summer. I started the summer with the intention of making my x86 inline assembly ray tracer solely assembly by not depending on C for the Windows GUI processing. But I also decided to improve it by adding the ability to automatically adjust the ray tracer's focal length in response to the user resizing the window. But this revealed a bug in my code. If you saw my previous x86 assembly videos, you'll recognize this scene and program. I always wondered why there was a rather pronounced specular highlight. It didn't bother me too much because I felt it made the glass look shinier and more realistic. But once I added the new resize adjustment capability, I saw that something was wrong. After looking into it, I realized there was a bug in the specular computation, or rather a bug that caused the specular computation to be wrong. When I originally manually converted my C ray tracer to assembly, I tried to optimize it at the same time. At one point I saw that the ray vector was being normalized. I figured I didn't need that because I felt the ray vector would already be normalized, but it turns out it isn't. A non-normalized ray vector didn't bother the diffuse, reflection, and refraction computations, but it did bother the specular computation. So here's the normalization put back in. The glass probably doesn't look as nice, but at least there's no longer a large white area. Here's the new part that handles the focal length adjustment. You process the WM size message that is sent when the window is resized. The WM sizing message is sent while the window resize drag is occurring. It would be nice if a non-recursive ray trace was performed while the resize drag is taking place, so you could see what you would get. However, it doesn't work here, most likely because of the speedup method I used in the message loop. It's not very practical anyway, since the ray trace would likely take longer than the user would like while resizing, so it's commented out. When the window is resized, the new size is determined, the scene resolution and the necessary bitmap padding is calculated, and the new focal length is calculated. Then the old bitmap is deleted, and a new bitmap is created with the new size. Then the scene is reset and redrawn. I mentioned that I intended to do all the Windows GUI processing in assembly. Although I felt that I could do it, I didn't really want to, so I put it off and did some other things instead. I decided to write a path tracer. I'll show the results of that in a bit. But first I'll say that I usually develop my ray tracer and scenes in Windows, but for some reason I wrote the path tracing part using my Linux version, and of course made the new additions to the Windows version once it was working. This gave me the motivation to do something I thought about for a while, but never got around to doing, adding the interactivity that was in my Windows version to my Linux version. A big part of the interactivity is interactively changing the camera and light positions using mouse and keyboard controls. For the camera, one way the camera orientation can be changed is by adjusting the camera's yaw, pitch, and roll. But I especially wanted to add a scene diagnostic tool that I have in my Windows version. It will show the distance, normal, intersection point, inherent object color, object type, and pixel location of the pixel under the mouse pointer. The pixel represents a location in the 3D space of the scene. This is useful if, for example, you create a scene and all you get is a black screen, or if something just doesn't look right. Now to the path tracing I mentioned. For years, I had collected simple path tracers, but didn't do any path tracer coding for a few reasons. For one, path tracing isn't as practical as ray tracing because it requires many more samples per pixel than ray tracing. For another, I didn't want to reinvent my own wheel, so to speak, by rewriting all the ray tracer support code that would be needed in a path tracer, such as scene file parsing. But after looking over Peter Shirley's Ray Tracing in One Weekend series of books, I figured I could just add a few lines of code to my ray tracer to make it capable of path tracing as well, since most of the needed code was already in my ray tracer. By the way, Peter Shirley mentions in his book that it really is path tracing he's covering, even though he uses the more general ray tracing term. Here's the first of Peter Shirley's scenes I path-traced with my ray tracer. For comparison purposes, here's the same scene ray-traced. I put one light directly above the scene. The shadows are more pronounced because the light is only coming from a nearby single light source, rather than the whole environment. However, I could have used soft shadows to make the shadow transitions less abrupt. Here's the same scene gamma-corrected to make it lighter. Here's more of Peter Shirley's scenes path-traced by my ray tracer. First, the infamous Cornell box scene. On this image, you can clearly see some of the principles that make path tracing look photorealistic. For example, you can see the color bleeding. Path tracing works by allowing every surface to essentially become a light source if the surface is being lit by some other source. So the red and green walls, for example, are lighting up the boxes with red and green light. You can also see ambient occlusion. Ambient occlusion refers to the amount of ambient lighting each point in the scene is exposed to. You also get soft shadows and caustics for free. The other image is smaller to reduce the render time, since it required so many more samples per pixel to get a decent image. Here's what I'm talking about. Both these images were created using only one sample per pixel. The first one is using path tracing, and the second one is using just ray tracing. The ray-traced one clearly looks better, even though it doesn't look like a photo of an actual room. The earlier shown small image was, I believe, 1,089 samples per pixel, and another of Peter's scenes. The smaller image is a variation I created to test frosted glass. This one shows what it's like without frosted glass. The next two show a frosted glass look using what Peter Shirley and others call constant medium. Constant medium can give you subsurface scattering. The third image isn't using constant medium. It uses a method I created which randomly jitters the refraction ray. When you write a path tracer, you probably won't be sure that it's working properly. So one way to know is to path trace other people's scenes and compare. Thus, I did just that. Now, here's some path tracings derived from David Curry's blog post. Even white balls can look interesting path traced. Here they are using a darker environment. There's not enough contrast for my liking, so here's one with a darker ground. Here's my version of a scene by Kevin Beeson. I call it Spheres at the Gates of Dawn, which I borrowed from Pink Floyd's Piper at the Gates of Dawn, which apparently was borrowed from The Wind in the Willows. Kevin Beeson's path tracer uses cosine-weighted hemisphere sampling, so I had to add that to my path tracer. The first image uses cosine weighting, and the second one uses the method in Peter Shirley's first two books in the series. Here's another one of Kevin Beeson's scenes. Same sampling methods as the last one. Here's a scene that is from a shader toy path tracing shader. Unfortunately, I can't determine the author of that shader. The first image uses Peter Shirley's first and second book method of sampling. The second one uses cosine weighted. And this third one uses uniform hemisphere sampling. In case you thought path tracing seems to be just spheres, here's two scenes I created which use other objects. The first one is a 4D quaternion Julia fractal. I feel this image could easily be a photo of a real museum or gallery. And the second one is a Mandelbox fractal scene you might have seen before in my previous videos. This version loses some of the metallic look, but gains ambient occlusion. Here's a scene derived from Evan Wallace's WebGL path tracer, but I changed it by making the balls colored glass and making the scene only use indirect lighting, since currently my ray tracer doesn't correctly combine direct and indirect lighting. Here's it with different colors and slightly rotated. And another one. So let's animate it. Here's another scene derived from Evan Wallace's path tracer. I didn't know for sure if the scene language I created for my ray tracer could do recursion, or perhaps more accurately, if I could write recursion in my scene language. But it can, and I did. Higher recursion levels look kind of busy. One more thing about Peter Shirley's books. The GitHub page for his books contains the free books in the series as well as source code. The Issues tab shows various corrections, improvements, and clarifications that are being made to his books and code. One such correction, or maybe just a change in thinking, is the sampling method used in the first two books. Originally, random vectors are selected by using random points inside a unit sphere. The newer version selects random points on a unit sphere surface. The first image is the original method. The second image is the new method. Because I was pretty pleased with the results of improving the Linux version of my Raytracer, I decided to see if my Raytracer will still compile and run on an Amiga since I first created it on one. Many years ago, when my Amiga died, I continued development using MS-DOS and later Windows, so there were a lot of things added which might or might not compile on an Amiga. By the way, in the Amiga days, although I wrote the Raytracer on the Amiga, I usually ran it on a Sun workstation or Harris Nighthawk, since they were faster. Since I don't have a working Amiga anymore, I had to use an emulator. Here are the results. I had to add a few ifdef Amigas and had to break up a few source files into smaller ones due to compiler limitations. But it works, and I was even able to take out at least one ifdef Amiga. The unexpanded Amiga didn't have the color capability that people take for granted today, so it's hard to find a good way to display the resulting images. However, after recording this segment, I got the emulator to emulate a 32-bit color graphics card with much higher resolutions. This is done by emulating the various graphics expansion cards that were available at the time the Amiga was being sold. I even modified my Raytracer code and makefile to use the Amiga's math coprocessor, so it runs even faster than shown here. But it did require tracking down many compiler bugs, including one that reversed the parameters of the power function. Imagine my surprise when I found out 3 to the power of 4 is 64. I also collected and ran on the emulator most of the programs I wrote for the Amiga. In some cases, I had to modify things a little to adjust to the faster system and to adjust to a hard drive instead of floppies. I now am essentially using a much better Amiga than I owned. While doing the path tracing work, my fluorescent light went bad. It's one of those 18-inch, 15-watt fluorescent bulbs. Since it didn't work anymore, I decided to see if my Tesla coil would light it up. It did. This might be the first time on YouTube where two bulbs are lit by a Tesla coil at the same time. I usually keep a few dying bulbs around for use until I get a chance to buy a new one. But all my dying bulbs have had all their useful life used up. They won't light up at all the normal way. But my Tesla coil doesn't know that. Actually, there is a good reason why the Tesla coil lights them. These bulbs work by heating up mercury, making it a gas, and then bombarding the mercury gas with electrons, which then cause the mercury to emit ultraviolet light. The UV light then excites the phosphors, making the bulb glow. The Tesla coil indirectly excites the mercury, which then excites the phosphors. You'll have to take my word for it that these bulbs are bad. However, the dark ends are a pretty good sign they're bad. Every time a bulb starts up from a cold bulb, filaments or heaters heat up the mercury. These heaters, over time, burn off more and more of the filament material, which then settles in rings around the ends of the tube. Eventually, enough is burned off to make the bulb not work anymore. One day in the summer, I also looked through some stuff in my garage to find some old magazines that I used to look through several times when I was a kid. Maybe I'll do a video on these magazines. In some cases, I didn't need to search for them because I found out they were archived online. You can download PDFs of at least 2 of these issues. Here's a project in one of the magazines that might be of interest to some of the Logisim users. It's a circuit that uses a video game chip to play hockey, soccer, and tennis on your oscilloscope. This uses an analog oscilloscope, but today's digital oscilloscopes would probably also work as long as they have external sync and a Z-axis input. They also provide the PCB traces so you can etch your own board. If you haven't done so yet, please subscribe, like, share, comment, etc. And if you click subscribe, click the bell to receive notifications of future videos. Even if you click the bell, still check back from time to time, since YouTube doesn't always notify subscribers.